Florida State Patrol. Listen to James Earlwright and Sergeant Buddy Lee Butcher.
Advance, let's hear these comments now from Brian Bryan and the Z-Man.
I'd like to take this time, Z-Man, to thank all the fans out there that supported our efforts in the tag team division. I'll tell you what, we're not going to disappoint you. We're going to get back in competition.
In and out of the ring, fans, we're still friends. And we're a great team in the ring. We intend to prove it right here today. Right, partner?
You know it.
Comments from Flying Brian and Z-Man. There's good old Norman in a completely different attire. And Bob caught a little bit late in the program. You got some news on Norman, do you not?
That's right. We talked to Mike Rotunda, who knows the full story now about Norman. And I tell you, it's a very touching story too, Jim. And I think all of the fans are going to be interested in that. You want to stay to hear that from Mike Rotunda.
We'll have that a little bit later in the broadcast, just in a few moments. We'll tell you where Norman has been and why he is dressed as he is. A little bit later, that special feature with Bob Collin, Norman's best pal, Captain Mike Rotunda. Sergeant Buddy Lee Parker, the State Patrol, stepping out to start it off with Z-Man. Nice arm drag takeover. Bob, whether it's in single competition or tag team competition, Flying Brian and Z-Man are great young athletes and a credit to World Championship Wrestling.
They certainly are that, Jim. And you know, they've been doing a lot of singles wrestling. We haven't seen a great deal of them as tag teams lately, but they're still friends, they're still tag team partners, and they're going to keep continuing to wrestle as tag team partners.
Good drop kick by the Z-Man. Really an agile athlete, a former Mr. Minnesota. Spends a lot of time in the gymnasium keeping himself into tip-top condition, as does Flying Brian. You'll find no excess body fat on these two young guys.
No, sir. Both of them have tremendous bodies, tremendous muscle tone. They're both so quick and so agile in the ring. They got a lot of speed over in that corner. Of course, across the ring, I think the State Patrol, they could outpower them if they ever get the opportunity to grab them, hold on to them, keep them down, take them down to the mat.
Great quickness by Flying Brian, taking over Lieutenant James Earlwright. And the senior member of the State Patrol finds himself in a very disadvantageous position. He works his way back to a vertical base. As Bob Cottle pointed out, both members of the State Patrol with a low center of gravity are very strong, very powerful individuals. But Flying Brian is so quick.
Well, I tell you, it's hard to overcome that, Jim, when you got the quickness and the agility and the speed. When you know how to use it and to use it to your advantage, that's awfully hard to overcome in the ring.
Flying Brian made the tag to the Z-Man. Nice back kick on the Lieutenant. And another one from the backside by Z-Man on top. Lateral press got two. Bob, we've got some great action. Four big events this weekend, not only in Florida, but also in the great states of Mississippi and Alabama coming up.
Oh, man, we certainly have, Jim. It's going to be a great week for the NWA and for World Championship Wrestling. For instance, tonight we're going to be in St. Petersburg at the Bayfront Arena and Meridian, Mississippi at Ray Stadium. All of that tonight. Tomorrow night, Miami at the Knight Center and Mobile at the Civic Center.
Four big events tonight in St. Pete and Meridian, Mississippi, and tomorrow night in Miami, Florida at the Knight Center and Mobile, Alabama in the Civic Center there. Of course, back Monday night with our great fans in northern Georgia, the Georgia Mountain Center.
In good old Gainesville, Jim. Brian in trouble now, and he's in bad trouble.
The State Patrol, who have been tag teaming a long time, they're both tag team specialists, no doubt about it. And they're really double-teaming Flying Brian in their corner. This would be a great upset and a great victory for the careers of the State Patrol if they could pull out a victory here.
They saw that match as this, an opportunity for them to take a giant leap right up the ladder.
Pillman hip-locking his way out of it. Nice spinning karate kick on Lieutenant James Earlwright. Snap Merzing back down to the canvas and tagging in the Z-Man. These two youngsters, Brian Bryan, as a matter of fact, just got back from Cincinnati, was there for Brian Blados, one of the football players of the Bengals, bachelor party. So Brian keeps in close contact with his former teammates of the Bengals, and his resting tights certainly exemplify that as well.
Yes, sir. He's an outstanding young man, Jim. Got a great personality about him, but I tell you, he's a fierce competitor, and that's what you got to have in this sport of professional wrestling. You got to be a competitor.
I think Bobby summed it up just right when he said a fierce competitor, because anybody that's on the special teams in the NFL, it's got to be tough. And Z-Man is not only tough, but he's quick. 6 feet two, 250 pounds. And that handsome youngster, one of the eligible bachelors in World Championship Wrestling, taking down Sergeant Buddy Lee Parker using that wrist lock. Z-Man has great technique. These two kids have really come a long way in their short careers thus far in professional wrestling.
Got that arm and he's got that wrist. He's got good leverage on it. As a member of the patrol was down on his knees and up above him, Z-Man could get that leverage. Boy, that's a good scoop, though.
You know, Bob, I noticed on some of the scheduling that Flying Brian has a match coming up with Mean Mark.
That's where he's certainly going to be tested, and all of his agility, all of his quickness will be tested in that one, because Big Mark, he's so big, so strong, and so powerful. And I tell you, for a big man, he's got a lot of agility. So, Jim, that's going to be a hard one to figure.
It's going to be a great challenge for Pillman when he takes on Mean Mark in the next few weeks. And there's a tag made. State Patrol now trying to double team Flying Brian. Caught him low with a clothesline. Lateral press. Didn't get the leg grapevined and then didn't get the pin.
He could hold him as he kicked out of it. Just talking about Mean Mark. You know, a little later during this hour too, Jim, we're going to take a look at a guy, a scary individual, and that's Big Van Vader. And fans, if you haven't seen that, you don't want to miss that. This guy is unique. Awesome is a word I think you got to apply to him.
Exclusive footage from the Great American Bash featuring Big Van Vader in the program. It's over time. Oh, what a move.
Jim, and he got up and drop kicked him over the top rope, and he was on the rope. Can you believe he got that high in the air?
Pillman certainly comes by his nickname, Flying Brian, very honestly, because this kid has got great spring in his leg.
Boy, sitting on the rope, and when you think about how tall he is and sitting up there and how high the rope is, he must have had to get up about 6 or 8 feet for that drop kick, more than that.
Pillman right through the ropes, nailing both the State Patrol, and down they go like dominoes.
Now, this is the kind of action that you come to expect from these two youngsters. As we say, they're so fast and they're so quick in the ring. They like the up-tempo type match, and that's the way they want to wrestle the State Patrol. Although, as strong as they are, Jim, you know the State Patrol would like it to be a much, much slower tempo.
Fans, if you just joined us, the new World's Heavyweight Champion, Sting, will be making his first wrestling appearance on World Championship Wrestling a little bit later in this broadcast. 2 big hours here tonight on World Championship Wrestling. So call your friends. They'll see the World's Heavyweight Champion in the ring tonight.
Does that tell you something about the champion? You know, after winning that championship, Jim, he could have taken a month off and gone to Hawaii, been on the beaches or something. But no, because of all of his fans that stood behind him, and especially the little stingers that mean so much to him, he says, I want to wrestle, and I want to wrestle on World Championship Wrestling tonight.
That match with Sting, plus Big Van Vader here, Ric Flair and Barry Windham will be in tag team action as well. Those comments from the Horsemen at the top of the program, they are dead serious about their business right now, just as serious as Lieutenant James Earl Wright is about hammering away at Brian Bryant. Tag made, here comes Buddy Lee Parker back in the match. And the State Patrol trying to put Pillman away, using Wright's head as a battering ram, putting Pillman back on the canvas. There's a lateral press. They're going for it. 1-2, and Pillman kicks out.
Well, you can certainly tell that the Highway Patrol, the State Highway Patrolmen, are veteran tag team partners. They know how to tag, and know how to work very well as partners. So far, that has been to their advantage in the match.
Pillman being rammed into the steel security railing by Lieutenant Wright out there, now being blatantly choked as referee Randy Anderson is trying to restrain Parker and Zink back in the ring. Pillman now has really been battered.
Pillman needs to get over to make a tag. He needs to get the fresh man in the ring right now.
Ryan Bryant suplexed down by Parker. And the State Patrol tagging in and out very effectively in our first contest here on World Championship Wrestling this great Saturday night. Double karate thrust by Lieutenant James Earl Wright, drops the leg on Pillman.
He almost had it pinned, a count of two. And if Z-Man hadn't gotten there, it could have all been over.
State Patrol, no tag was made. Referee still having problems maintaining Z-Man's comportment there on the outside of the ring. Headbutt by Parker.
Well, you can tell the patrol were ready for this match, Jim. As you say, it meant so much to them. A big jump right up the ladder in tag team competition if they were to pull off the upset. They're prepared for it. They're ready for it.
Tag made. Here comes James Earl Wright. Crowd chanting, go, Brian, go. And he lands on his feet.
Oh.
Good move by Brian Bryant. Up and over. Pillman now makes the tag to the Z-Man. The Z-Man here cracks the heads of the State Patrol together. Karate kicks Lieutenant James Earl Wright out of the ring. Clothesline. Randy Anderson almost got it. The Z-Man on fire here. His adrenaline is flowing. Here comes Pillman. Can he do it? He drop kicks it. Oh, what a drop kick. Pillman was in orbit there. Here comes the Z-Man up and over. Pillman and Z-Man have electrified this crowd on World Championship Wrestling.
Ladies and gentlemen,
victory for Pillman and Z-Man, Bob.
Well, Flying Brian certainly lived up to his reputation in this one. Watch again just how high he gets into the air, and that dropkick exploded perfectly right on the chin. Then it was 1-2-3 when Z-Man came flying over the top rope with the assist here from Brian. What's this move?
Ladies and gentlemen, the wrestling wrap-up is next, and I'll talk live to the new World's Heavyweight Champion next on TBS. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to World Championship Wrestling and TBS. This edition of the Wrestling Wrap-Up will center around, first of all, where has Norman been? One of the most popular athletes ever in World Championship Wrestling, Norman has been very conspicuous with his absence. Well, recently, Bob Caudle, our colleague, got together with Mike Rotunda, who, as we all know, Captain Mike is Norman's best pal. And Bob has some questions to ask Mike. Just where has Norman been? He's encountered a very severe tragedy in his life. But right now, let's go to Bob Caudle, who is standing by with Captain Mike and this report on Norman.
Fans, with us right now, here's Mike Rotunda. Mike, we wanted to talk to you because you're the best friend of Big Norman. Norman has been gone for some time, but last week we saw him just come out and make a brief appearance. He was down around the ring. What is it with Norman right now?
Well, you know, Bob Caudle, everywhere I've been in the past month or so, people have been asking me, where is Norman? How's he doing?
Yeah.
And to be quite honest with them, I said, I don't know. I haven't seen Norman. He just kind of disappeared. But last night I got a chance to talk to Norman, Bob, and it was on no vacation that he was, because I found out that Norman's dad had passed away. He had died.
Terrible.
And I also got a chance to sit down and see another side of Norman that I have never seen in knowing him in the past 6 months or so. In talking to Norman, it seems like that he's anxious to get back to his little kids, to see the people again. He's dressing different. He's wearing truck driver's clothes. And I asked him why he was dressed different, and I found out that his dad was a trucker. And he's going to dedicate all his matches to his dad's memory, and he's just real excited about getting back to the people, and I'm sure he could use a friend right now, so he'll be back soon.
Fans, it's going to be a new Norman, and I'm sure we'll be seeing more of that Norman.
We certainly look forward to Norman getting back in action. Perhaps he'll be here with us next week on World Championship Wrestling. Also, ladies and gentlemen, last week here on the program, we saw a wild match involving Tommy Wildfire Rich and Stan the Lariat Hansen. At the conclusion of that match, Stan Hansen, due to his actions and physically abusing the official, referee Randy Anderson, Hansen was suspended. We're going to go back in time and show you just exactly why Hansen was suspended, and then hear some words that I had with head referee Nick Patrick about the actions and the conduct of Stan the Lariat Hansen.
And for the last few minutes, Rich has turned it around. He's started to wrestle him. He hasn't stood toe-to-toe with him. He's wrestling a much smarter match right now.
Tommy Rich with that great conditioning. And another near fall. Rich taking it right to big Stan Hansen. Rich has got a lot of guts. He's not intimidated. And he caught the foot right in the face. Oh, man. He caught that big black boot right in the face. And Hansen drops it all on him. But he didn't try to pin him. Now Hansen wants to fight.
He had him down. He could have covered him with a press. I don't know whether he could have held him or not. But instead, he went with those right hands. He just wants to punish him. He wants to hurt Rich now.
Tommy Rich quickly moves out of the way to avoid that elbow. And Tommy fights back. Man, Tommy came to fight here. Hansen's got to be a little frustrated.
Well, we said earlier that he was over the rope.
That's all of it. He's going to get disqualified for that.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match by disqualification, Wildfire, Tommy Rich.
He delivered.
He just larried the referee. Hanson just closed on Pee Wee Anderson and then kicked him in the head. I don't believe this. Ridiculous. They cannot tolerate this.
No way.
They can't tolerate this. He just stopped on Pee Wee. Anderson doesn't weigh 140 pounds. Then Tommy Rich with that bell around the side of the head. Hanson has gone off. We need medical attention for Pee Wee Anderson. Hanson has just destroyed the referee.
NWA, as you said, cannot tolerate this kind of an action from any competitor, regardless of who it is. And the referee, there you see him holding that head. Jim, he's hurt.
We're back here, ladies and gentlemen, with senior referee Nick Patrick. And Nick, you can't let this thing go on with Stan Hansen.
Well, I realize a lot of things happen between wrestlers, but whenever a wrestler touches a referee, then he's gone too far. And as of right now, Stan Hansen is suspended for 30 days and fined $5,000.
I know that you've got to put some meat in these rules, and he's going to be suspended for 30 days. He's got to learn to respect the official.
What do you mean suspended? Nobody's suspended. What are you talking about, boy?
30 days suspension and a $5,000 fine.
$5,000?
Hey, if you put your hands on me, we'll double the fine and make the suspension for a year.
Harris, nobody suspends me. Nobody. Let me tell you something. Nobody. Nobody suspends me. I'm going to get.
Ladies and gentlemen, on July the 7th, at the Great American Bash, a new world heavyweight champion was crowned. It's my privilege and pleasure to introduce the Stinger to the audience here on TBS and World Championship Wrestling, and indeed, they are standing in this arena tonight. How does it feel? It's soaked in now. You are the world champion. What are your thoughts at this time?
Well, I'll tell you something, Rusty. It's a lot different feeling now. All of a sudden, you got newspapers, you got radio stations, TV interviews, pictures, TV, people wanting to talk all the time. It's amazing. It's like I'm in the limelight all of a sudden. It's a strange feeling, but you know something? In my own eyes, the way I feel about myself, I am just the regular, I'm just still the Stinger. There's nothing different about me. And the chances of me not going out there and high-fiving everybody, howling a little bit, high-fiving the little ones, small ones, big ones, whatever. I haven't changed. I'm still the same Stinger, Rossi.
Woo! All right, fans, those comments from the heavyweight champion of the world. And we will see him right here today on World Championship Wrestling. And we'll be back with more on TBS right after this timeout. Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to World Championship Wrestling. Before we see Big Sid Vicious in action, let's hear these very solemn comments from the Horseman.
Something has happened within the organization. Something has gone wrong. And now, we don't have a thing to lose. Because now when we step into any ring, when we come to any building in any city in this country, we're hungry. Sting and Luger seem to think that they're sitting on top of the world right now. But when I go home and look in the mirror, I think about the things that I've had and the things that I'm going to have. These two guys right here, along with Flair, have got nothing to lose just like me. And everybody out there is going to find out just how vengeful a bunch of guys that don't care about anything can be.
We protected that title with our heart and soul. We got nothing on earth to lose. We did a lot of rope-a-doping in the past. A lot of shucking and jiving, a lot of playing with the women, all dead news, nothing but business. You got to get out of each car in each town, every gym you go in, every restaurant you go in, you look over your shoulder. We're not above jumping on you and TCBY yogurt. It may sound funny to you, but it's dead serious. I'm looking at a bunch of dead men as we speak. Big Sid?
Sting! No matter what I gotta do, if it's to break every bone in your body, I will get that title back in the family of the Four Horsemen, no matter what it takes.
Still the symbol of excellence, bottom line.
Wrestling fans, the following contest except the one fall, making his way into the ring area, a member of the Four Horsemen. From Metropolis, weighing 319 pounds, this is Sid Vicious. In the ring, his opponent from Valdosta, Georgia, weighing 245 pounds, Tim Hughes.
Bob, I think we have to address what we have just heard. The Horsemen are deadly serious about what they're saying. Sting and his friends are no doubt marked men as far as the Horsemen are concerned, and I would not want to be in Tim Hughes' shoes for anything on earth.
No, you're 100% right, because when you get a guy as big and as powerful and as mean as this Sid Vicious, and when you take all of the Horsemen and lump them together, they say that it doesn't matter where his friends are. They're going to get Sting, they're going to get his friends. When you got guys like this, guys like Barry Windham, Arn Anderson, Jim, I don't think anybody's going to be safe.
The Horsemen are at they're dangerous anyway, Bob, but now that Sting has wrestled the World's Heavyweight Championship away from what many consider the greatest world champion of all time, he has not only affected Ric Flair's life, but he's affected the lives of each and every Horseman. And I think what we see here is the fact that Sting is a man that the Horsemen want to put out of action. They want to cripple a guy. They want to be able to win the championship back. And anybody that's standing with Sting, like Luger, the Steiners, Junkyard Dog, they're marked men.
Well, you would think that they would. Oh, my heavens. That shows you just how rough and how vicious this Sid Vicious can be. Jim, you would think that they would be sportsman enough and have enough sportsmanship about them when the champion was pinned and he was pinned fairly and he was pinned squarely in the ring by Sting, that they would say, hey, you beat me, guy. All right, let's see if I can take it back from you. But no, they're not those type of individuals.
They certainly aren't. They are at their ruthless best, if you can say that. That may be an oxymoron, but they are at the most sadistic state that I have ever seen them. And the tone of their interviews, I think, really sets the stage for the way they feel. They were not out here bragging. No. They were not out here laughing. They were not jovial. They were not congenial in their own way. They were deadly serious about what they're going to do with Sting. And the interesting part about it is that Sting has already signed.
Yeah, that's right.
Some tag team matches.
Yeah, and you know what? He said he's going to fulfill those contracts. And he's the type of person who would do that, Jim. So I don't know. I don't know whether he's going to make it through those or not. He's going to have some help. His friends are really going to have to rally around him. There's no doubt in my mind that that's got to occur. No one man can stand up to the Horsemen alone.
Bob, that's exactly right. And it's great that Sting has friends. He certainly has a lot of them. Not only in wrestling, but the great fans that have jammed this arena here. Jam-packed to the rafters. Many of them to see Sting, who will be wrestling later in this show. So don't tune away. Remember, Sting is here wrestling here on World Championship Wrestling tonight, plus Ric Flair and Barry Windham. Could there be fireworks? We'll find out a little bit later in the show.
There certainly could.
Big Sid Vicious now has completely dominated Tim Hughes. There's a power bomb. 6'9", 330 pounds. He wants to hurt somebody, as he said.
Wrestling fans, here's your winner, Sid Vicious.
He said on the interview he's got to break every bone in Sting's body. That's what he will do, and the big man means it.
And the big man is certainly big enough, strong enough, and powerful enough to do it. Watch his power move. He's going to lift Hughes up. He's got him this way, Jim, just that power move as he drives him so hard right down to the mat. Every bit of the steam went out of Hughes on that one, as well as his breath. And there's your winner, Big Sid Vicious.
Fans, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff made some comments earlier. Let's hear them now.
You know, Mr. Wonderful isn't the type of guy that turns his back on a fight. I was brought up the old-fashioned way, the way they used to do it back in the olden days. If you had a problem with somebody, you'd go behind the outhouse, behind the barn, you and the man you was with, and you'd settle that situation. But the Four Horsemen are the type that like to gang up and hurt people. Well, I'm going to tell you, Arn Anderson, you may be the spearhead of this, but when it's all over and done with, you're going to have to face me.
Bob,
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is set for one fall, making his way to the ring area from Atlanta, Georgia. Weighing 214 pounds, Wildfire Tommy Rich. And in the ring, his opponent from the dark side, this is the Shadow.
As the Shadow prepares to take on Tommy Wildfire Rich, let's hear these comments Tommy made just a few moments ago.
You know, somebody say something about the Wildfire be the happiest pappy in the world, because once in my life, I know what life's all about. Whether it be Bam Bam Bigelow, the Horseman, Stan the Laird Hansen, I'm doing it one more time, and it is for my baby, so bring it on.
It's always great to hear from Tommy Wildfire Rich, and Bob, the days ahead for Tommy Rich are like I think they will. He's going to have to really be ready, because a big man from Borger, Texas, by the name of Stan Hansen, will be back in a few weeks from suspension. Plus, Tommy has got a match signed with 400-pound Bam Bam Bigelow. He takes the big ones on, doesn't he?
Oh, he gets the big ones, no doubt about it. And, of course, he and Hansen, former friends, former tag team partners. Hansen suspended 30 days for what he did to Tommy Rich right on television. But as you say, not much longer. That suspension is going to be over. And you know, Hansen, the type of person that he's in, he's carrying vengeance in his heart. He's wanting to repay Rich.
Well, Bob, I think we should clarify that the referee, Nick Patrick, head referee Nick Patrick, suspended Stan Hansen for his physical abuse of referee Randy Anderson. And Tommy Rich was involved in that situation. And you can bet that when Hansen gets back from suspension, that he'll be looking Tommy Rich up. But he's not a hard man to find, as they say. And the Shadow, big man, moving quite well, but Tommy Rich got underneath him there. Nice hip lock takeover by Wildfire.
Well, and the Wildfire tells us that he's in great shape now, Jim. He's thinned down a little bit. He's got a lot of his quickness and speed back that he thought he had lost. That was due to the fact, I think, that he had gained a little weight, and he was a little heavier than he wanted to be. But he seems just as quick and just as fast to us as ever in the ring.
He's just right now, Bob. And I'll tell you, one city that loves Tommy Rich is Gainesville, Georgia. We'll be back in the Georgia Mountain Center on Monday night, by the way, fans, at 7:30.
And you know, not long ago, with the Clash of Champions in Charleston, South Carolina, we had a great crowd there, Jim, as well as a great night of wrestling. We're going to be back in Charleston this coming Thursday night at the McAllister Fieldhouse. Also in Wilmington, North Carolina, the Legion Stadium. And we're getting in my territory now. Wilmington on Thursday night and Friday night in Fayetteville, North Carolina, at the Cumberland County Civic Center and at the Richmond Coliseum.
The Shadow's head rammed into the top turnbuckle. Tommy Rich, he is just fired up. Tommy has really been on a hot streak in recent weeks. And when he dropped from 248 to 220, you regain that quickness, and that's always been a strong attribute of Tommy Rich. Not only is fighting hard and his resiliency, but his quickness, and now he's got that quickness back.
But I tell you, he's going to need every ounce of it when you get in like a man about Bam Bam. Jim, there's a huge individual, Bam Bam. If he ever gets Rich off his feet, gets him down on the mat, Bigelow could just sit on him, and what would Rich do with a man that size?
I don't know what anyone could do with a man like Bam Bam Bigelow, but Tommy is... he's a veteran. I think he'll have a game plan together. Irish whip by the big masked man, who must weigh 300 pounds himself. He's a big son of a gun.
Well, as you said, Rich takes on the big ones.
But he's 100 pounds less than Bam Bam Bigelow.
Right. And I tell you, he moves well, but Jim, he does not move like Bam Bam.
Big man on top, lateral press. He got two out of that one. We're going to hear some comments a little later in this segment from the Junkyard Dog, who just, it's the old situation, guilt by association. He's associated with Sting, and JYD, I'll tell you, is proud to be Sting's friend. He was Sting's buddy before Sting won the World's Championship, and it's still that way today.
You got to admire him, Jim. He said, too, I'm his friend. I'm going to stay his friend. I'm not going to back up. He says, I'm going to go with him. I'm going to protect his back. And he says, come on, Horseman, I'll be here. And that's the type of guy he is.
In upcoming weeks, Sting, along with Lex Luger, the Junkyard Dog, will be taking on the Horseman in a big six-man tag team event, fans. If that match is signed for your arena, whatever you do, make your plans on attending, because it's going to be some wild action. We know what the Horsemen want. I don't think they care about winning a match in a tag team environment. They want to hurt people,
right,
specifically the world champion.
They not only want to hurt him, they want to finish him. They want to put him out of wrestling, and they want to put him out permanently. You know, they came just that close to doing that, Jim. That was an extremely serious and almost career-ending injury that Sting suffered, and it was only the fact that, and it was a very serious operation, He was out, what, 6 months or so, Jim, and it was really a minor miracle that he was able to come back from that.
A lesser athlete would never have made it. I don't know if Sting's in the category by himself as far as that's concerned. And the shadow taking it right to Tommy Wildfire Rich. That big black boot right into the throat of Tommy Rich. And Wildfire certainly at a distinct disadvantage here as referee Nick Patrick chastises the masked man, tells him to get him out of the ropes. Well, we got a great weekend here, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, I was going to say, Jim, you talk about the matches coming up, and we got two more great hours tomorrow night right here on TBS at 6:05, the NW main event, and then at 7:05, a special presentation of the Power Hour. The Power Hour on Sunday this week instead of Friday night, Jim. So we got two great hours coming tomorrow night beginning at 6:05.
Tommy Rich just fell out right on his head on the concrete. Tommy has really been battered here. It's going to be a tribute for him just to make his way back into the ring. And his lights have been dimmed by this big masked man who I think is making his first appearance here on World Championship Wrestling. I can't remember seeing the shadow before. And he is certainly a force.
Yeah, I have not seen him, Jim. I would remember a man this big, a man the size of the shadow, especially since the way he can wrestle in the ring. He's rough and tough, and he's a real competitor. He's a hard one to go against.
Tommy Rich with that headbutt down in the lower stomach region and slams the masked man's head right to the canvas.
I think Rich is showing us right now that conditioning that he's in, Jim, and how much losing that weight, how much he's worked to get in great shape has paid off for him.
Tommy missed that drop kick and the big masked man takes advantage. Must mean he's a veteran. And Tommy Rich's feet are on the ropes. That's a veteran move as well. Barely got out of it. Big straight right hand. That's a big right hand nailing Tommy. As Bob said, two big hours tomorrow night right here on TBS. 2 hours tonight and 2 hours tomorrow night. And the Power Hour, a special presentation. United States Tag Team Championship match tomorrow night. We'll tell you more about that in the hour. Tommy Rich now back up to his feet. I don't think he can go fist and fire this big monster.
No, he didn't want to stand toe-to-toe.
But he can share wrestling, Bob, and that's what he's doing. Tommy Rich, that's what it says in the marquee, is wrestling. And the lateral press got two out of that move. Tommy sends it to the ropes on the near side. Gets it this time with that drop kick. And now Wildfire is going to pay back some in kind, perhaps.
Well, he's got the shadow right where he wants him in the corner. Right up above him, just pile drives that right hand right to the head.
Irish whip. Shadow catches Tommy coming in. X-Force signs him down with authority on top. This may be all. 1-2, and Rich kicks out with a half a count to spare.
Rich got a little careless, Jim, when he came charging in at the shadow in the corner. You wouldn't expect that from Tommy Rich.
Tommy misses that. He ducked into that one. There's a vertical press.
Oh,
he didn't get it. Oh, that Luthes press did not work this time. He was hot-shotted over the top rope. 1-2, and Rich has got that shoulder up, and just barely.
Rich was pinned.
He is hanging on for dear life, Bob.
Boy, I thought he was pinned there when he was coming down again with that third count.
Tommy underneath. There's a quick move. He's got his legs in place. Can he hold him down? And he does. Wildfire has won it. A hard-fought victory for Tommy Rich.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Wildfire, Tommy Rich.
We said he was resilient. We said he was a strategist. The big masked man was looking for the Thez press, but Tommy delivered something else.
And it looked like he was not going to be able to get back from that. Look here as he goes right under, right between the legs. Hooks him. Puts the shoulders to the mat for the count of three.
Fans, the biggest dog in the yard, made some comments recently. Here's the junkyard dog.
You're going to be getting all kind of reports, all kind of telephone calls, different people bugging me in my ear, telling me how bad, how mad, how vicious, and the different things that the horseman is saying about the dog, or what they're going to do to the dog whenever they find the dog, or how they're going to do it to the dog. But they're forgetting one thing. What can a dog do to you? Don't take me small, baby. I'm still alive, and I'll be here to the end. Sting, Luger, the dog, and Orange.
Ladies and gentlemen, the following contest is a special tag team match. Introducing first, the godfather, Theodore R. Long.
This is a team of doom. From Hollywood, Florida, weighing 260 pounds, Dave Johnson.
Dave Johnson and Bobby Mercedes to take on Doom. And man, we've got some comments from Theodore Long. Let's listen to his comments.
The Great American Bash, the new revolution. Now that proved one thing to you, rock and roll, that you'll never be five times NWA World Tag Team Champion. But I got a rumor that you're still running behind Doom, chasing these belts. Well, let me tell you something right now. You keep on running, keep on coming, you'll never get them.
And fans, I want to correct that. It's Tony Burton and Dave Johnson. Might not hear their names too much after tonight because they're in there with Doom right now.
They may not be around after tonight.
That's Dave Johnson, by the way.
If there's a more physical and more overpowering team than Doom in professional wrestling, Jim, I got to see them.
I think you're right, Bob. This is a team that is so dominant. They have, they match up physically quite obviously with any tag team in wrestling. It's going to take a team that is quick, a team that can control the tempo and can keep these big monsters off balance to win the world championship. Now, like I think what I've just done is describe...
The Steiners. You have to me. I think the Steiners could do it.
And the Rock and Roll
and
Express.
Rock and Roll.
Speed, yeah. Agility.
That's right.
I think speed and agility is going to... If you try to wrestle a power match with Doom, I think you're walking up a real bad road.
Absolutely.
That's right down their alley.
And, of course, they've got that added advantage outside of the ring in their corner. And, you know, when Theodore Long first came along and said, I'm going to manage the Doom, I didn't think a great deal about that. Jim, I think he has surprised everybody in professional wrestling. That guy has got a brain on that head of his, and he has taken these two men right here, and he has made tremendous champions out of them.
Doesn't have a lot of hair on his head,
no,
but he's got a brain.
He's got a brain up there, that's right.
I guess that's what counts. He has really accelerated himself to... one of the top managerial positions in the sport today.
Of course, I'm not so sure that if you and I had a team like him, we could probably do very well with them also.
We'd have to really, really try hard to mess it up,
that's
Bob.
That's right.
They are a wrestling machine, no doubt about it. Both men, Simmons and Reed, great athletic backgrounds before they got into pro wrestling. They carried their football style, that head-hunting, straight-at-you style, right into pro wrestling, probably with as easy a transition as any ex-football player has ever made into pro wrestling.
And it's very obvious, Jim, here that Dave Johnson and Tony Burton are certainly overmatched against Doom.
As are most teams, for that matter. Ron Simmons, a powerful slam there. Referee Randy Anderson down, got two out of him. I think Simmons could have pinned Tony Burton right there if he had chosen to do so.
He didn't want to. He wanted to hurt him a little more, give him a little more punishment, make him so that he's never, ever want to get back in the ring against Doom.
Reed with a double axe handle blow on Tony Burton. This is a high-impact team. They won't grab a hold and utilize it, an arm bar, a leg lock, of any type of maneuver with that much regularity and that much continuity. What they like to do is come right at you with fists and feet, slams, clotheslines, high-impact moves. It just takes it out of you. And that's why their matches don't normally last too long.
Extremely physical team. They know how to dish out the punishment. But, Jim, they can also take it.
This should be all right here.
Good.
And it should
be. He didn't want to.
It should have been right there. Reed likes beating up people, as does Simmons.
He had that smirk on his face. He said, I want to hurt him a little more, and he just lifted him up. By the way, fans, next Saturday night, Knoxville Civic Coliseum, World Championship Wrestling will be in Knoxville. And then next Sunday night, that's going to be the 29th of July, Jim, we're going to be in Asheville at the Civic Center there in the good old mountains.
And fans, we want to remind our 900 number listeners, our callers that call the wrestling hotline to get all the up-to-date information. We've got some big news for you tonight about what I think the Horsemen are going to be doing the next few days to take over Sting as Reed pile drives Burton into the canvas. This will be all. I got a big announcement about July 28th for our hotline, and Reed again refuses to pin the man. Fans, on July 28th, that's 1 week from tonight, beginning at 7 o'clock Eastern Time, you can talk live to some of the biggest stars in World Championship Wrestling, including many of the Dudes with Attitudes, live on the Wrestling Hotline. That's a week from tonight, beginning at 7 o'clock Eastern Time for our Wrestling Hotline callers. Tony Burton may have wished he would have stayed in his hometown. This is quite an orientation and indoctrination to World Championship Wrestling that he's receiving at the hands specifically now of Butch Reed and soon from Ron Simmons.
Well, he has really been taking a tremendous pounding and beating.
Double clothesline by the World Tag Team Champions. And Simmons with a very lax press.
Hey, come on now.
You know, somewhere the referee's got to, I think, interject himself.
It's a little too much.
They are really dominant here. They like to beat people up. They say they'll do it to the Rock and Roll Express the next time they see them as well. High elevation by Reed on Tony Burton.
Jim, I think they must think that the Rock and Roll is watching this. That they're going to say, hey, Rock and Roll, this can happen to you.
Reed just nailed Johnson, and Simmons has just pinned Tony Burton. Doom, the champions have won it.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winners of the match, the World Tag Team Champions, the Team of Doom.
Jim, not only did they finally pin him, but watch this move as they come off of the ropes. Big Ron Simmons, here he comes. When they get him to the mat, he's going to do push-ups off his chest and off his stomach while he holds him to the mat.
Ladies and gentlemen, don't forget Two Big Hours right here tomorrow night on TBS. Here's Paul E. Dangerously to tell you about this Sunday night's Danger Zone.
Well, every time there's a new heavyweight champion of the world, all the media comes down, everybody comes in wanting to get the exclusive. Well, tomorrow night on the Danger Zone, the new heavyweight champion of the world, Sting, will have to face me, Paul E. Dangerously.
Wrestling fans, the following contest is set for one fall. Introducing first, from Memphis, Tennessee, Ricky Morton, Robert Gibson, the Rock and Roll Express. In the ring, there are bullets, first from Atlantic Beach, North Carolina, at 235 pounds, Snake Watson. And his partner from Knoxville, Tennessee, weighing 229 pounds, Joe Kazana.
Kazana and Watson to challenge the Rock and Roll Express. There's good old Norman back out there. I tell you, Bob, that talk you had with Mike Rotunda earlier certainly let us all know exactly what Norman's been through in recent weeks.
Jim, that's right, and I tell you, he sort of dedicated himself. He's dedicated his life, and he's dedicated his career professional wrestling to his dad, which I think is a tremendous thing. And it's brought a complete change in Norman, his entire personality, and I think you're going to see a complete change in the way he works in the ring.
He's lost about 50 pounds.
Yes, sir. Oh, boy. Jim, he's very serious about it. It was a very personal, serious thing to Norman.
Joe Kassano, the side headlock on Robert Gibson. Well, I'm sure the Rock and Roll Express are on the monitors watching the last match where Doom was just so dominant, physically intimidating their opponents, as Joe Kassano maintains that side headlock on Ricky Morton. Crowd chant. Wait a minute, there's Kenny Long.
What's he doing coming down here?
Kenny Long really, I can't pick up what he's saying. But he is really letting Ricky Morton have it.
He's all over Morton's case over there in the corner.
Kenny Long out there just making a fool of himself.
I don't know whether he's trying to intimidate him or not, but we, both of us, we've been around rock and roll long enough. We know him well enough to know that regardless of who the competition is, how big, how strong, or how rough, these two guys are not going to be intimidated by anybody or anything.
Ricky Morton shows a good sportsmanship, but not taking out on Kenny Long. And Kazana catches Robert Gibson there in the, with an elbow coming into the corner, nails him again. It sounded like Long was trying to make some kind of challenge. Said, you want some of Doom?
He's always got something to say. He stepped in no man's land there. Ricky Morton, now the goodness of his heart, didn't take care of it.
Wait a minute, here comes Long now. Up here, Jim. Let's see if we can get him in to find out just what the heck he was doing.
What are you doing down there, Teddy?
What were you doing down
there? You saw what I was doing down there. I was issuing a challenge to either Ricky Morton or Robert Gibson to take on Butch Reed, or Ricky Morton can take on Ron Simmons one-on-one, tag team or whatever. They're running scared. They're slipping and sliding. I'm sick and tired of it. I'm going to put a stop to this once and for all, Jim Ross.
You want Rock and Roll to accept a challenge then for a one-on-one match with one of your guys?
Yeah, that's right. I went down there and challenged them. They told me no. We're scared to wrestle Doom. You heard exactly what they said.
I didn't hear that.
You better get the cotton out of your ears, Bob Collar. You and Jim Ross both. You heard what I said. Ricky Morton can get on Ron Simmons, but Reed will get on Robert Gibson, or they can take all four. It don't make no difference to me. I'm sick and tired of the Rock and Roll, and I want to get rid of once and for all.
Well, maybe we can get to... Maybe we'll be able to talk. I'll be talking to Rock and Roll a little bit later in the program, and I'll ask him if they'll accept the challenge.
Well, you ask them a little later on in the program, and you be sure that you get back to me and let me be the first to know, Jim Ross. Now, I'm getting out of here because I'm sick and tired of it.
All right, well, feelings mutual, I'll tell you that. Teddy Long wants a one-on-one match with either of his men against either the Rock and Roll. We've got some interview time scheduled, the Rock and Roll, a little bit later tonight.
Yeah, and he must have had a hard blow to the head and been hearing voices if he heard Ricky Morton say no to the question of, hey, wrestle one of my men.
He's listening to MC Hammer a little too loud in his Walkman or something. He's a little punchy today. Kazan up in the lights, and Robert Gibson put him there. Fans, don't forget now, it's still to come. The world's heavyweight champion, Sting, will be wrestling on this broadcast. Ric Flair and Barry Windham together on this broadcast. And Bob, that special feature exclusively from the Great American Bash.
Yeah, we're going to take a look at, I tell you, a really scary individual to me. And that's Big Van Vader, 399 pounds. Heck, you may as well say 400. What's a pound when you get that big, Jim? But this big man is, I'm sure, a force that a lot of people within the NWA are going to have to reckon with. He's scary, he's big, he's strong, he's powerful. One-on-one, I can't think off of the top of my head who's going to be able to hold that big man down.
Steg Watson had a handful of tights there to turn Robert Gibson over. Still to come in this segment, we'll hear comments from Paul E. Dangerously, and we'll see Mean Mark Callis in action as well. And Snake Watson, as you saw there, using the tights for leverage. This crowd here loves a Rock and Roll Express.
I tell you, fans across the entire country love him. And I don't care what Teddy Long says. I think it would be classic matchup. Either both of these guys against Doom or Morton or Gibson. Either one in there, Jim. We got quickness, we got speed, we got agility against the big power and the strength of Doom.
Straight right hand by Robert Gibson after the atomic drop by Morton.
And I don't believe I that old saw either that a good big man will always beat a good little man. In the case of the Rock and Roll, I don't think that might hold true.
That theory will not hold water,
sir.
Bob.
Will not.
Snake Watson trying to fight from underneath, but to no avail. Robert Gibson takes him over the arm bar, right into the overhand wrist lock. And Snake Watson did make the tag to Joe Cassana. Cassana coming in, stomping away at the ribs of Robert Gibson. Now raking at his eyes. Cassana with a straight right hand and a scoop slam. Joe Cassana turning it on here on TBS, and Gibson kicks out at two.
Well, with a slam he did, but you know, you always think that when the man goes to the eyes, it's a desperation move. He doesn't have anything else to do. All he's got to do is go to the eyes, figure that's going to slow him down, and it does. It's the equalizer.
Gibson caught Cassana coming in with a foot, and he's in Dream Street.
I tell you, he reeled around there and went straight face down to the mat. It was like a tree falling.
Nice snap there by Robert Gibson into a reverse chin lock. Robert controlling the action here. I tell you, I cannot wait until the Rock and Roll Express get an opportunity to wrestle for the World Tag Team Championship. I really believe that it's going to take a team that is quick and have great technique to beat a big power team like Doom.
And again, Jim, I think I may be overdoing it a little bit when we talk about the strength and the power. I don't mean to at least say in any way that Rock and Roll is not a strong team. Robert Gibson is not a small individual. Gibson's a big man. Gibson's strong. Gibson's a powerful individual. So he can hold his own against a lot of big power men in the ring.
And nobody in wrestling is more quicker than that young man right there, Ricky Morton. And in my opinion, nobody in the sport has Ricky Morton's fighting heart.
Right.
We've seen him take a beating after beating, and he's still back to compete. That's why they've been the World Tag Team Champions on four occasions.
Well, he's kept himself in excellent condition, and as you say, he's got that heart as big as All Outdoors, and it's carried him a long, long way. That plus his tremendous ability.
Near fall, Robert Gibson got two out of that lateral press. Single leg pickup on Snake Moss, puts him to the canvas, and quickly tags in Ricky Morton again. Now we'll see Vintage Rock and Roll Express, and they nail Kazana, and here it comes, the double drop kick. That's 420 pounds in doom.
Wrestling fans, do it all at the Rock and Roll Express.
We'll find out a little bit later in the program if they'll go one-on-one with Doom. But right now, let's take another look at the double dropkick.
And as you say, Jim, Doom or no Doom, it doesn't matter how big you are. When they come with that double dropkick, they both get so high. They've got it timed perfectly. They always do, and it lands right on the button as it explodes right on the chin and on the chest. The double dropkick. There are your winners.
Ladies and gentlemen, the man with the biggest mouth since Howard Stern, Paul E. Dangerously, had this to say.
Yo, Sting, to make it to the danger zone tomorrow night, you got to survive for 24 more hours. And for you, my friend, that just might be a very difficult task. But what won't be a difficult task is me, Mort Callis, disposing of one flying Brian Pillman. You know, Pillman, I know all about your college credentials. I know what a great football player you were. But my friend, that doesn't make you a great professional wrestler. I mean, Steffi Graf can hit a tennis ball right through a brick wall. She can't get in the ring. Nolan Ryan at 43 can pitch a no-hitter. He can't get in the ring. Not against a guy 6'9". Not against a guy 325 pounds. Not against the master of the hard punch. Not against the master of the heat-seeking missile. Not against the most awesome human machine of destruction on God's green earth, Brian Pillman. You're finished.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is set for one fall. Paul E. Dangerously presents from Houston, Texas, at 319 pounds, Mean Mark Callis. His opponent from San Juan, Puerto Rico, Joe Padera.
And Joe Padera just got nailed by Mean Mark. Those comments earlier from Paul E. Dangerously. I don't think he has to worry about Sting being in the danger zone. Oh, my goodness. Unless the horsemen have something up their sleeve in this program. Mean Mark, so agile, and Flying Brian has got to be one of the most courageous athletes, because Pillman's about 225. He's outweighed approximately 100 pounds,
yes,
by this big 6'9 monster.
And you talk about agility, you saw how high he could get into the air and how he can jump and how he can move. Not only is he big, tall, heavy, but this guy has got a tremendous amount of agility and athletic ability about him. He can really move around in the ring.
You know, Bob, I think that one of the reasons of his agility is the fact that he did play collegiate basketball.
Yeah.
A big power forward. He weighed about 275 in college. He's put on almost 50 pounds of solid muscle since he joined professional wrestling. And that glove right hand is a difference maker.
Oh, I was going to say, you know, now just think about all of that agility and the athletic ability that he's got, and you combine that with that very deadly heart punch that he possesses.
Don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, two big hours of wrestling here this Sunday night, beginning at 6:05 for the NWA main event, where Paul E. Dangerously will talk to Sting in the danger zone. I wonder if Paul E. could be in any kind of collusion with the horseman on that situation, Bob. It wouldn't surprise me.
No, I wouldn't be a bit surprised about that. I think he's the type of individual that would do that. That's the type of personality he's got, and that's the type of person he is. Look at that. When you talk about ability and athletic ability and agility, Jim, how many 6'9 men that are as heavy as this man is can do that?
None that I know, Bob. He is a very elite class of athlete that has been gifted with the size at 6'9", 319. What a mouth. What a face.
Well, that was that right hand of the head. He had him set. He could have probably gone for the hard punch.
Flying Brian must be at his all-time quick best to wrestle this big guy. Fell behind-the-back suplex. He can wrestle and he can brawl.
Well, boy, when he gives you the suplex, 6'9" tall, you're about 8 or 9 feet up in the air, and that's a long way to come down on the back of the neck.
Elbow drop.
Again, he lit him up.
Paul Lee very, very vocal at ringside saying hurt him. Paul Lee looking forward to the NWA returning to the Meadowlands in East Rutherford, New Jersey on Friday night, August the 24th, that big event.
Jimmy, if you just look back at the matches that we've already seen, how the professional wrestler...
Oh, he got him right there, Bob. That heart punch, he nailed him. It just pulverized Joe Padera. And that is it. Brian Bryan has best beware of the heart punch.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Mean Mark Callan.
Bob, it could come out of anywhere.
You know, normally you will see him set the opponent up for that, but as you say, he can come from anywhere. He came with this one right out of the corner. And when he lands that heart punch, we have yet to see anybody get up from it. And there it is. Down he goes. He's out after that.
Ladies and gentlemen, coming up next on TBS, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff. He's on deck on World Championship Wrestling.
Wrestling fans, the following contest is set for one fall, making his way to the ring area from Tampa, Florida, at 241 pounds, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff. In the ring, his opponent from Chattanooga, Tennessee, weighing 210 pounds, Paul Lee.
Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, ladies and gentlemen, has a match with Destiny, with Arn Anderson. Here are the comments.
It's cut and dried, Paul Orndorff. There's people in this world that have things, people in this world that want things. I'm a horseman, I'm the world television champion. My friend, if you want to jump on me, I will assure you, coming back from the grave, life as you know it is over, pal. Cut and dried.
Back to action here, ladies and gentlemen. Paul Lee making his debut here in World Championship Wrestling against a double tough one, Bob. A real veteran and a great guy now living in Fayetteville, Georgia, Mr. Wonderful Paul Orndorff.
And you know, Orndorff is another one that is marked for extinction by the Four Horsemen. Another one of the dudes with attitudes along with the Junkyard Dog. This man right here, he's got to watch his back. He's got to be careful wherever he goes. And the horsemen say, Jim, you know, we can do it in the parking lot, we can do it in the arena, we can do it in the grocery store, we can do it in the restaurant. They don't know where it's going to happen. We'll get them, though.
Paul Lee missed that clothesline, but Mr. Wonderful did not. Orndorff now, very, very dominant. And his pile driver against Arn Anderson's DDT is going to be a matchup of two great finishing maneuvers. And Paul Lee holding on for dear life. And Lee won't sprain any ankles where he landed. Pee-wee Anderson. And convincing Mr. Wonderful not to do what he was thinking about.
Yeah, that's right. He finally convinced him, Jim. I started to say earlier when you had Big Mean Mark out there, you know, I think you can look at some of the wrestlers that we've seen already during the program. The difference in the wrestlers, Jim, that are they're big and they're huge, but they're great athletes. Mean Mark, Sid Vicious, Doom. Those are just some that come to mind. But hey, how about the biggest of all, this El Gigante?
And fans, if you get a chance to see El Gigante in action, be sure and take the kids out to see what is the biggest athlete in all of professional sport. In any sport, and that is El Gigante, 7'7", 435 pounds. He looks big on TV, and let me tell you, he is. But when you see him in person, you can really see how big this man is, Bob. He took my breath the first time I saw him in person.
He absolutely does, and you see him walking beside a big man and a tall man, and he doesn't even come up to his shoulders. The tall man will fit right under his arms or come just across his chest. That's how big. 7'7" is unbelievable.
Nice move there by Mr. Wonderful. Caught him with a clothesline. Drops that elbow right on Paul Lee. I tell you, we've seen El Gigante next to the Junkyard Dog. Now, JYD is 6'3", 310 pounds, and he looks like an ebony version of Lord Littlebrook next to El Gigante.
Yeah, it is breathtaking. You just can't believe that there's a man that big. Watch out.
Paul Lee being dominated by Mr. Wonderful. And you've got to think that Mr. Wonderful is basically sending a very subtle message to Arn Anderson.
Yeah, I'm surprised.
You want to be tough? You want to be rough? Well, I can too, and I will when I face you.
Yeah, I'm sort of surprised that Orndorff is doing some of the things he's doing. But again, I think he's showing Arn Anderson that, hey, guy, I can do it too. If you want to do it, hey, we'll fight fire with fire. We'll come right back with it.
Orndorff has been in the ring with the sport's biggest stars, headline cards around the world, and he will be doing so again here in World Championship Wrestling when he faces the enforcer of the Horsemen, Arn Anderson, in a match that I personally do not want to miss. Well, he's got that hammerlock now. Young Paul Lee from Chattanooga, Tennessee, and we'll be in the great state of Tennessee 1 week from tonight in Knoxville at the Civic Coliseum. Orndorff with the wrist lock. Orndorff played running back for the University of Tampa, a native Floridian. And as I said, he and his family now living very happily in the beautiful community of Fayetteville, Georgia, just south of Atlanta.
Jim, you know that if you had third down, a yard to go, you were on the goal line looking for that touchdown, this would have been the kind of man you would want to give the ball to.
And they did too, Bob. He helped their records there. They have put out some great football players. Freddie Solomon, Paul Orndorff, John Matusak. The late John Matusak, I should say. And here comes the deciding maneuver.
It's been all Orndorff.
Watch this. And he's straight down. We can say goodnight and goodbye to Paul Lee. Arn Anderson, take a long look.
The winner of the match, Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff.
We'll take another look at it, fans. And still to come in a few moments, that feature on Big Van Vader.
And here is that pile driver, Paul Orndorff, with Paul Lee. And as you said, the enforcer, Arn Anderson. If Arn ever gets in this position, it's going to be lights out for Anderson, just like it was for Paul Lee.
Ladies and gentlemen, he's 399 pounds. Perhaps the most dominant force in the 90s. Could it be Big Van Vader? We'll take a close look at this big monster when we come back on TBS. Welcome back, everyone, to World Championship Wrestling. Jim Ross and Bob Cottle back with you here on TBS. Still to come, the world's heavyweight champion Sting will be in action, plus the Horsemen, Ric Flair and Barry Windham in tag team action as well. But, Bob, at the Great American Bash, we saw the debut of a man 399 pounds. You've been in the sport a little bit longer than I. What'd you think of Big Van Vader?
Jim, that man is scary. As you say, 399 pounds, very aggressive, very physical, very powerful. That headpiece is intimidating alone, some kind of samurai ancient warrior headpiece. That blows steam and smoke out of it. I think you're going to see a lot of Van Vader, and I think guys around the NWA have got to be on their toes.
Men like the world's heavyweight champion Sting, Lex Luger, the United States heavyweight champion, must look over their shoulder because Van Vader is certainly a force to be reckoned with.
He's so powerful, he's so strong, so intimidating. Jim, I don't know who can stop a guy that big and that strong and that powerful.
The fans in the Baltimore arena were certainly in awe, ladies and gentlemen, when Van Vader made his appearance. We're going to show you not only his entrance, but also his match with the Z-Man from the Bash.
Attire
there.
May
may be some type of samurai ceremony that he's doing, Jim, with that headpiece. My heaven.
Van Vader, that's, as I said, there's very few ways to describe.
Wow.
The steam shooting from that, there's nothing connected at all to to that apparatus that he's wearing. This is one big, big man, 399 pounds. We have seen videotape of him in action. He is one of the most sadistic, one of the most physically intimidating athletes that I have ever seen, Bob, in my career.
And Z-Man has got to be wondering, what the heck am I going to do and how am I going to wrestle a guy like this?
Z-Man, an outstanding competitor. But will he be enough on this occasion to withstand Big Van Vader? Big clubbing forearms.
Well, that's certainly not where he wants to be, back in that corner and caught there to take those tremendous blows from Vader. Some way, Z-Man's got to rely on his quickness and speed.
.399 right to the corner. The Z-Man doing all he can to stand. You got to admire this youngster for accepting this challenge and signing a contract to wrestle this very brutal man. And there's a clothesline, a short one right to the side of the head of Tom Zink, the Z-Man. Referee Randy Anderson checking the Z-Man. He's almost out of it right now. What a blow.
A man that big has got to be very, very strong. And there he shows you just some of that tremendous strength. He just lifts him up right by the ears, right over the top rope.
Hauntingly strong. Missed with that clothesline. Drop kick. Just
his feet didn't go down.
Didn't go down. Caught midair is a Z-Man. Look at the strength of this big man. This big monster's holding Z-Man up, who weighed in at 251. Military press slam. This man is dangerous. Drops it all. 399 on the Z-Man. And Big Van Vader, so dominant here at the Great American Bash. And you're seeing, ladies and gentlemen, the first North American appearance of this big man.
Jim, I don't want to say impressive is the word. I would have to say bizarre is the way it is with this guy.
Vertical suplex. Man, he's vertical suplex. He just nailed him. People are looking at this man in awe.
Listen, everybody's stunned, really.
Veteran wrestling fans that just are speechless. Oh, what a clothesline. Tom Zink may be speechless as well. Big splash, 399. He's got the leg grapevine. My goodness, Big Van Vader is devastating. This big man is awesome.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match, Big Van Vader.
And there, fans, you get another look at the big man, Big Van Vader. And Jim, Z-Man never really was able to get any offense on track. Was all this big man from the very beginning. And when he came with his flash and hooked the leg, there was no way the Z-Man was going to get up from there.
399. Tremendous move here. This man who came to the ring awed this entire crowd. We're going to go back and look. That shoulder pad headgear apparatus that he wears completely detached from his body, but as we worshipped it earlier, there he is again. Steam is blowing. Quite a man, I'll tell you that. Big Van Vader, 399 pounds. And if he ever gets the opportunity to wrestle for the World's Heavyweight Championship, our pal Sting, best beware.
Jim, I saw a lot of the wrestlers around. Everybody was looking at him. Everybody wanted to see, hey, what's down the road for me? What have I got to face a little later? Very, very rough, very tough.
Sting has to be aware of this situation, ladies and gentlemen. The new World's Heavyweight Champion, as a matter of fact, will be coming up next. The first appearance here on World Championship Wrestling of the new heavyweight champion of the world is next, right here on TBS.
Ladies and gentlemen, this match is set for one fall, making his way to the ring area at 250 pounds from Venice Beach, California, the brand new World Heavyweight Champion, America.
What an ovation for the heavyweight champion of the world, the Stinger, who wanted to be with his fans.
this man, Jim?
He has come back from instant mental loss to capture the richest prize in wrestling from the greatest world champion of all time, the Nature Boy. We're going to see the Stinger in action. But right now, let's go back up to Tony Gillen.
His opponent from Jacksonville, Florida, ranked 233 pounds, Barry Horowitz.
This capacity crowd to their feet when the world champion made his way to the ring. Little Bart Simpson there. I wonder if Bart got his hair cut after the Stinger. Fans, and they love him.
He's got great charisma. He loves the fans just as much as they love him. And that's something that shows in an athlete. You can't hide something like that.
You know, Bob, we're 2 weeks since the Great American Bash now. This kid, I've been with him on many, many occasions with the media, around fans. I've seen him stop interviews so he could sign an autograph, so he could talk to some youngster and go back to the media. He hasn't changed a bit. He is still as thankful for his opportunities, for his God-given ability, and for the support of the fans, especially the little kids, the little singers, as he calls them.
You know, I think he's the most down-to-earth champion that I've ever known, Jim. Sting will tell you, he says, I haven't changed. I'm still the same person that I always was. It's just the fact that I've got a championship belt right now. But he's still got the same personality. He doesn't have a big bloated ego in that head of his. He's just a great individual.
His chest still bruised from that brutal match with Nature Boy Ric Flair. Available now on video cassette. We'll be telling you how you can order that in upcoming days. The Great American Bash video. High hip lock. The Stinger, another high hip lock. So agile and so strong. Horowitz goes upstairs. With a little encouragement from Sting, the Stinger will be on the danger zone this Sunday night on the NWA main event. And as I said earlier, we know that Ric Flair and Barry Windham are in the facility. They'll be wrestling next. But will Paulie dangerously stoop to an all-time low and have collusion with the Horseman and set a trap?
He certainly could. I wouldn't put that past Paulie dangerously, and I certainly wouldn't put it past the Horseman.
Horowitz with a thumb to the eye. That's the only thing that slowed Sting down thus far was that thumb to the eye. And Horowitz rakes the back. He won't get a pin with that. He's just trying to frustrate Sting, and that may be the wrong thing to do. Good headbutt by Horowitz. Straight right hand, and the world's champion has yet to go off his feet.
He went down to one knee, but look how quickly he bounced back up again. And speaking of knee, in that knee, Jim, as you say, 2 weeks ago at the Great American Bash, that was the first time that knee had been tested since we had, watch out. Horowitz kicked him right behind that knee and on that leg again. That's going to get him riled up.
Sting. Adrenaline is flowing through the veins of the champion of the world from Venice Beach, California. Since Horowitz hit the ride. Clotheslines him out of his boots. Man, he is so poised. Ready for the challenges. He has signed tag team contracts to wrestle with Lex Luger and the Junkyard Dog in tag team matches against the Horsemen.
Against the Horsemen.
And he's going to honor those contracts, Bob.
And even though the Horsemen say that they're going to try and do whatever they can and everything within their power to end his career, to put him out, to hurt him, and to hurt him bad, he says, I signed him, I'm going to honor him.
Big elbow by the Stinger. And the world's champion on his first wrestling appearance here on World Championship Wrestling has looked just tremendous. Look at this elevation by the champion. Drops the elbow. Drops all 250 pounds on Barry Horowitz. And with just that one yell, he brings them to their feet. Poised here in the corner. Here comes the Irish whip. Followed by that Stinger splash. He's right there. And he plants Horowitz in the corner. Sting now.
They know what's coming. Yes, sir. Here comes the Scorpion, I believe, Jim.
The Scorpion Deathlock. And the Stinger sets back on it. That's his move. The champion of the world has won one here in convincing fashion. And they love it. They love the new world champion.
Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the match,
as you say, Jim, he won it in convincing fashion over Barry Horowitz, the man that wanted his fans and wanted to wrestle for his fans, and he wants to give them an outstanding match every time he goes into the ring, and he certainly did it here against Horowitz.
Bobby felt like he owed it to the fans, especially those young fans, to wrestle right here on national television. And boy, did he ever. The Scorpion Deathlock is locked in. Still to come, Ric Flair and Barry Windham. But first, let's hear this from Missy Hyatt.
Join me, Missy Hyatt, right here on TBS at 6:05 for the NWA's main event. We're going to have a special Danger Zone with Paulie Dangerously. His guest is going to be the new World's Heavyweight Champion, Sting. I just hope Sting doesn't hurt Paulie. He's such a goofy guy.
Welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, to World Championship Wrestling. Let's hear these comments from Nature Boy, Ric Flair.
The question is asked of me now, daily. Am I at a crossroads in my career? The answer, point blank, is no. Sting, you are at a crossroads in your career. You have the burden now of being the man that beat Ric Flair. You have the burden, pal, of being the man that took the world title away from the Horseman. The bragging rights, the notoriety, the money, everything that we thrive on daily, pal, you took. So look at it like this. We got nothing to lose. Nothing. Fines, they mean nothing. Hurd, Turner, they tell us nothing. We are on a beat to get that world title back. And Sting, broken bones, blood, guts. Think about it, pal. I paid the price. Now, pal, you've got to pay the price to be in the hot seat. Woo!
Wrestling fans, the following contest is a tag team event. Introducing first team number one. These two gentlemen represent the Four Horsemen. Introducing first from Sweetwater, Texas, at 275 pounds, Barry Windham. And his partner from Charlotte, North Carolina, weighing in at 241 pounds, Nature Boy.
Signal seven times. Coming up. Don't count him out, I'll assure you. His comments were deadly serious, directed towards Sting and the dudes with attitudes. Let's go back to Tony Hill.
Entering their opponents, first from Havana, Cuba, at 280 pounds, Art Missa. And his partner from Iowa City, Iowa, at 210 pounds, James McKinnon.
James McKinnon and Art Missa. Take on Ric Flair and Barry Windham, and I wouldn't want to be in those two gentlemen's shoes, speaking of Mesa and McKinnon.
That's right.
Because they're going to be, in my opinion, be made an example to Sting and his pals as to what's in store for them. Now, at least the Horsemen will be doing it now inside the ring. For Sting and company, it may happen anywhere, at any time, at any arena.
Well, the Horsemen say that. They say as much. Then that's probably where it is going to happen, because I think if it happens, it's going to happen in a sneak attack, and it will not happen in the ring for sure.
Windham with that big forearm. Windham 6'6", 275. And I'll tell you what, that big guy from Sweetwater, Texas is all man. And he and Flair, what a tag team combination they make. Throwing a man outside. Now Flair will go outside. You can bet he'll do some damage here. He means business, and he is physical.
Well, as he came down to the ring, Jim, as you say, he held up seven fingers seven times, world champion, which means that in his mind right now, he's got one goal, and his eyes are set on that goal, and he's going to keep them right there, and that's to win back that championship, of course, from Sting.
Windham throws his opponent back in the ring, the Horseman, whether it be in tag team competition, as has been signed, the Horseman. Flair and company against Sting and a partner. It could be Lex Luger. It could be Luger and JYD. But wherever it is, we know that their objective, it is clear cut. It has been made public. And Flair's comments, I've never heard him more serious.
No.
I've never heard him more deadly than we heard a few moments ago.
Usually, Flair is very loud. He's like a real braggart out there as he's bragging about what he's going to do. But, Jim, you're right. He was very quiet. He was very serious, and like he says, this is what I'm going to do, and you better believe that it's going to end the way I say it's going to end. And as you said before, don't count him out. He's done it six times. Anybody that's done it six certainly can do it seven, if you're a Ric Flair, that is.
Big chops by Flair, and they are so dominant here. They're very brutal, very physical. You cannot take away, obviously, from the Flair and Windham's athletic ability. Very few men in the history of wrestling have ever possessed their skills and their ability to perform night after night on a winning mode as the Horsemen.
Well, and just when a lot of the wrestling experts were saying that the Horsemen were on the decline, that their sun had set, so to speak, what does Arn Anderson and Ole Anderson do but go out and come up with a Sid Vicious? Barry Windham becomes a member of the Horsemen. Jim, I think they're even more deadly now than they've ever been before.
Windham using the steel railing as a weapon. Flair now working on the leg.
Get up!
Of Art
get
Mason.
Up. You deserve a shot. Why are you staying? Why are you losing?
Well, I don't think Sting will be very hard to find, Jim.
I just have a real uneasy feeling about the danger zone this Sunday night on TBS. And Flair, this slapping this young man in the face. James McKinney. Oh, what a chop. Man, I know how Custer felt now.
Fans, a quick reminder right here. Two more great hours of wrestling tomorrow night right here on TBS beginning at 6:05. That's going to be the NW main event and a special presentation of the Power Hour. Callers at 7:05. All of that tomorrow right here on TBS.
Flair, the vicious kick to the ribs. You gotta wonder. Gotta wonder when Flair's gonna go for the figure four, or if he will in this match, because one has to think that sooner or later, that's the move that Flair wants to get on Sting, the figure four, and really, let's hear that leg snap, crackle, and pop. That's gotta be Flair's objective.
Excuse me, Jim. He wants to get it, of course, as you say, on that injured knee, on the knee that was operated on. That's where he wants to do it. And the figure four on that can mean the end of a career.
I don't know exactly where the tag match has been signed, but fans, if that tag match is signed for your hometown or near your hometown, or Sting and a partner, whether it be Luger or JYD, are involved against the Horsemen, don't you dare miss it, because you know what the Horsemen want to do to Sting. Flair, the big kick right to the face. He helped the World's Heavyweight Championship six times, and no one dominated a decade like Flair dominated the 80s. And I'm not going to sit here and say that he will not dominate the 90s, because he is that great.
He certainly is, and hey, he's got the figure four now locked in. Right, there it goes.
There's no one that's perfected this move like Ric Flair, and Flair would like to break the leg of this youngster right here. Flair and Windham so dominant.
The winners of the match, the Four Horsemen, Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and Barry Windham.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we said, two big hours this Sunday night right here on TBS. The Power Hour at 7:05, and here's Jim Cornette to tell us more.
This is Jim Cornette reminding you that the NWA Power Hour can be seen tomorrow night at 7:05. That's Sunday night for the Power Hour. My guest on the Louisville Slugger is going to be the Junkyard Dog. We're going to find out if his bite is as bad as his bark. And also, the Midnight Express is going to defend the United States Tag Team title. What more could you ask for from the Power Hour tomorrow?
Championship wrestling. I'll tell you one thing. These great fans here love the Rock and Roll Express. I'll tell you that. And we heard Teddy Long out here a little bit earlier. He wants to challenge either one of you guys, either Robert or you, Ricky, to a one-on-one match with either one of Doom. Now, we've got some time on the main event tomorrow night. He said, well, find out if Morton will accept the challenge. So what do you got to say? Will you want to wrestle Ron Simmons tomorrow night on TBS?
Well, let me put this way here, Jim. Time after time after time, we have stepped in the ring with Doom, and we have proved to the whole world and all these fans out here that they couldn't beat us two on two. But you see, it's like this right here, Teddy Long. We don't care what it takes, whatever you want. All we want is a title shot. Now, if you want me tomorrow night, brother, you have got us. We don't care what it takes. I'll accept a match with any one of your guys, anytime, any place, especially tomorrow night.
Well, I'll tell you something. You know, Ron Simmons is one big bad dude, Ricky. It's going to take a great game plan to get a guy like that down because he is a tough son of a gun.
Well, Jim, like you know, Robert and I have been in a lot of tough matches. I'm talking about chain matches, strap matches, any kind of match there is. We don't care how big and bad they are. They can always be had.
Let me say something to you right now, pal. I'm going to tell you something right now, Ricky Martin. You too, Robert Gibson. Now, I'm going to say it in your face. Either you step in the ring with Butch Reed or either you step in the ring with Ron Simmons. It makes no difference, buddy. Now, what do you got to say about that? Tomorrow night on the main event, I'll have Ron Simmons right here.
Well, tomorrow night, you have Ron Simmons here, and you have him ready, because I will be ready.
All right, now you accept the challenge.
Hey, I'm talking to you, man. You stay right here, punk. Don't ever walk away from the Godfather when he's talking to you, little man. I might even take you on myself. Hey, I'm not just...
Well, I guess he answered his question.
I'm through talking to you. Now, you have your guy ready tomorrow night, Ron Simmons, because I will be here early.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, well, we've got a few more moments. I don't have any idea how much time we have left. Teddy Long is lying here at my feet. Teddy, I'm sorry that you got nailed. Not really.
Ricky Martin, you signed your death warrant. You had no business putting your hands on the Godfather. Nobody abuses me. Ricky Martin, tomorrow.